Behind me is a portrait of the contemporary displaced person, the contemporary refugee. So children, women, the old, infirm are being displaced from our cities by war, by natural disaster, and by things like a fiscal crisis. They are displaced from cities into fields of mud where NGOs, who we've come to rely upon in order to service these people, can provide food, water, and medicine, but shelter is much less of a priority, and they certainly can't deliver emergency urbanism. This is a project that looks at ways of delivering emergency urbanism quickly and locally and sustainability. So the last photograph was an image of a camp that has been around for about a year, roughly 1 million people being displaced out of Syria into places like Lebanon, Jordan, etc. This camp, however, is a place where I've done some work over the past 5 years in Sri Lanka. So this is the Puttalam Sultan camp for Muslim refugees displaced by war. It's in northwest Sri Lanka, and it's been in existence for 20 years now. On average, these places exist for 19 years, and they double in population every 17 years. They're confined by land, and they're put in places where people don't want to use the land. That is the restriction. So as the population grows, the density troubles the camp, and we have things like violence, crowding, spread of disease, etc. As you can see, these environments are largely ad hoc, made by hand. In this camp, NGOs have been in the camp 3 times and have quickly left to move on to other emergencies. Unfortunately, because of the frequency of these events, NGOs have become short-term operators. In this photo, you see a tin roof delivered by the UNHCR. The rest of the construction here, though, is done by children. In this photograph over here, you can see 2 residents of the camps, children at about 8 years old. In my time in the camp, I've never seen a working-age adult, and I've never seen a woman, only children. All of the men in that photograph are landlords. They're responsible for administering the camp and collecting the lease. So working-age adults leave these camps, and they go to earn money elsewhere, send it back to pay for the land, essentially, and the children are left to fend for themselves. If you look at these camps, they are full of things like half-finished toilets. I was told that the Puttalam camp has sewer lines under the road, but they're not connected to the toilets. So the people become distrustful of NGOs. They fend for themselves and they build for themselves. But in looking at the camp as an architect, you begin to study the materials, the materiality of the camp. In this case, the children are building out of sustainable local palms. So they strip the palm leaves, they weave them into these panels called kanjon construction. Unfortunately, what the children don't know is that this type of construction harbors malaria-bearing mosquitoes, and it's easily penetrated by rats, snakes, and other pests. The other thing that we can see from the photograph is that the entire environment of woven palm rots every 6 months. This is an environment that's ankle deep in water 6 months out of the year. And so there's a sort of Sisyphusian task here where the children are basically required to rebuild their own town continuously. So I began looking at where these populations are, where displaced populations are in the world. This is old data. But I mapped out where the populations are and then began to look at materiality. It just so happens that the big populations of these camps coincide with places where earth-built technologies or making out of mud is the local tradition. There's a great website out there that claims that half of the people on the planet right now are living in buildings made out of dirt. So that correspondence was something that I wanted to work with. In this case, you can see not only a building made out of mud in Gujarat, India, but cultural form. So, you know, everyone in the world has a cultural form that they express not only in their art, but in their architecture as well. This one happens to be orthogonal and pyramidal. Examples from North Africa, this is Burkina Faso. They build these kind of beautiful peanut-shaped houses. And then we move on to Yemen, where this was kind of a eureka moment for me. We start to see multi-story buildings built out of mud. So if we're looking for ways to make emergency urbanism and expand vertically, I guess I came to the conclusion that I had found something. We could use mud to build mud cities for people who could possibly be in these camps for up to 20 years. The problem was, how do you deliver a mud city? You can't expect the people who live in these conditions to build for themselves. They're often malnourished, they've often been subject to violence, and as the populations are primarily children, women, the old and infirm, they certainly don't have the ability or the skills to construct cities for themselves. When I looked at examples of how architecture has intervened in these situations in the past, I broke it down into two categories. One being a sort of shelter delivery system, where we make things here in the first world, we hook them up to airplanes, we put them in boats, we hook them to helicopters, and we deliver them. The big risk here is a lack of cultural accommodation. So the things that we make, the shelters we make, don't necessarily house a family of 40, don't necessarily house a tribe or a clan within one of these refugee camps. The other way that we deliver intervention is through systems-based intervention. And the photo to my, well, to your right, is a manual block press. And this is one that I actually found in Sri Lanka. It was delivered by the Peace Corps just as the war was heating up. In that war, there was a lot of reprisal, destruction of buildings, and so the idea there was to give people autonomy and allow them to use these tools to self-determine their own built environment. And that's something that really appeals to me, giving over tools and allowing people to build for themselves, but not necessarily have the physical burden of doing the construction. The manual block press to me is an amazing example for this project. It's something that is portable, can be easily made, can be delivered, can be repaired really easily. Some of the problems, though, are in its caloric intake. So 7 grown men, well-nourished, could make about 500 blocks in a single day. Only 2/3 of those blocks would be usable in construction. The others would be weak or cracked. The other problem here is that you have to have masonry skills in order to build, or you're building something that could potentially fall down. So I wanted to look at ways that we could make an information age tectonic machine, something digi-mechanical, something that could be sort of controlled or fueled by a computational machine, but also something that could communicate through the telecommunications network, where we could deliver our knowledge to these people and build with them in a reciprocal relationship. I began to look at Formwork. So Formwork, as you know, surfaces that can find a liquid material, the liquid material cures, and you basically have structure. As I looked at that Formwork, I noticed that the Formwork had become animated. Over time, we've got Formwork that moves, rolls, climbs, walks, and flies from one layer to the next. Another historical example that is really important to the project is Edison's monolithic pour housing. So back in the early 1900s, Edison wanted to make a concrete business, and he decided, I need a product for my concrete, we're going to make concrete houses. And he devised this almost instantaneous formwork where you pull the liquid into the whole house. It was not only the house, but it was the furniture, the piano, the toilet, the bathtub, the bed, everything made out of concrete. So obviously they didn't sell. And the whole thing was sort of looked at as a failure. But the success here is the fact that within 4 days, Edison could set up this formwork, pour a house, and then walk away, and you'd have a building, a multi-story building. So I began looking at formwork. And formwork is basically just straight surfaces or curved surfaces that help to track those liquid materials. In this case, I was using hinged boards that could be driven or made into variable shapes just by using a hand crank or a hand drill. While that would allow me to make building shapes, so in this case, a section that could have served as a shelter, what I didn't like about this was that it was kind of limited to extrusion. And so I fattened up the plates to sort of be these cartridges where all of the internal motors, mechanisms, and servers could go inside this kind of protective cartridge. The big problem with this thing was that the material was leaking out between these sort of links in a chain. And so even though I had sort of figured out how to deliver the material inside, in this case, it was a kind of printing cartridge that would mix material. It could deliver concrete inside the form or liquefied mud or a mixture of both. You could configure it, the inside and outside form, to make walls, floors, etc. I was still having this problem where the gasket, and in this case you can see it's kind of just a fabric thing sticking out of the form, that gasket would get clogged and therefore sort of defeat the purpose of an autonomous or semi-autonomous machine. I could still do the shapes that I wanted to do with the formwork, but I was struggling with this gasket. In this case, you know, I was using quarter scale models to make walls and other things using plaster just to test things out. The proof of concept was there, but the gasket was a problem. So I moved forward with other models and started to develop what I call a blooming plate gasket, which essentially folded out of one cartridge and allowed for a continuous casting surface between these linked pieces. Once I got there, I realized that I had sort of the shape of the machine, at least the formwork that I wanted, and it allowed me to do things like make variable things, almost like a mechanical fabric that you could cast into. It could make vaulted forms, it could make walls, it could make modular types of forms that you could stack on top of one another in order to sort of make an urbanism. So again, using quarter scale models, I pumped them full of plaster, and the plaster, for the first time, really didn't spill out, and it was easy to unfold this model and then set up a different shape or another shape on top of this one and build at least cells for multi-story buildings. That's where I'm at right now with the models, just trying to invent different building forms. At the same time, Penn State engineering students have been working with me full scale to make pieces of the machine. So in this case, we're running this off of a cell phone. Ironically, people in these camps don't have money, they don't have possessions, but everyone has a cell phone, and they're all connected to the grid. In this case, we're using a boat battery and a window winding machine out of a truck, so common things to make this technology work. Excuse me. The hope is a deployable tectonic machine that can travel with these populations as they're displaced, remember their buildings, be a part of the way that they construct the environment for themselves and reconstruct it and expand it, but also because it's linked through telecommunication, we in the West can sort of defy our office-bound practice to help these people build, but also learn from their constructions as a way of having them influence our built environment as well. Thank you.